I am still trying to understand the difference between ranks and stops, even though to me they're kind of the same thing. And if you're an organist, you're probably yelling at your your iPhone right now what the difference is. But it's still a lot. Greetings across whatever you listen to podcasts on. This is the Silent Film Music Podcast with Ben Modell. It's the podcast that takes you inside the mind of someone as they prepare for, perform, and reflect upon performances of live musical accompaniments to silent films. I'm your host, Ben Modell. This is episode 54. I'm joined, as always, by my co-host, co-producer, and my friend, Kerr Lockhart. Hello, Kerr.
Hi, Ben. Hey, it's beginning to look a lot like December.
Yeah.
2022.
It's December now, and we've gotten through the year. And want to thank you again for all your work keeping not only me on task, but keeping the podcast coming out. I think we've basically done one a month for this year, which is, I'd say, about a 900% increase over my own productivity level when I was doing this by myself. So really, thanks so much for all you've done.
So, lately, you've been playing a lot of performances where, rather than bringing your mighty imaginary Wurlitzer, you've been wrestling with the instrument that's there, dealing with the equipment that is actually there installed. This is sort of a classic keyboard artist problem. Jazz musicians talk about it, even classical musicians who aren't well-heeled enough to bring their Bösendorfer with them.
Or, or don't have a deal with Yamaha or Steinway where one of their instruments is provided whenever they perform. So you have to adapt. Like any gigging musician, you show up, and okay, this is what this piano does or doesn't do. It becomes an exponential acclimatization, if I may use that word, when you're playing an organ, at least for me, because there are different characteristics of each organ. Plus, theater organs and pipe organs, they're different. And then there are various electric or electronic organs and theater organs that any given venue may have. And until you sit down at one and get to know it and its qualities and idiosyncrasies, there's a bit of a learning curve.
Not to mention the sound of the room itself.
The sound of the room, how long is the reverb, if it's a church space, or in the case of, as we'll hear in a little bit, the Ocean Grove Camp Meeting Association's Great Hall, which is a huge space.
And I hear it has a huge organ to match that huge space.
Yeah. I got a chance to play the gigantic pipe organ there. It's a large Robert Hope Jones pipe organ. According to the specs online, there's 5 manuals, 207 ranks, and 12,200 pipes. Now, a manual in the organ world refers to the keyboard, and ranks is a row of pipes that are of a certain sound or type of instrument sound and a certain octave.
Think of the term really comes from a reference to soldiers standing in ranks.
Yes. If you ever have a chance to go up into the chambers, you'll see this row of pipes, if you imagine a pan flute, except 6 feet long, you'll get to see that. And this was a situation where I had arrived the day before to spend some time getting used to the instrument, which I definitely needed. First of all, Ocean Grove, New Jersey is really, really nice. I'd never been there, but once Mona and I had gone and done this show, we're telling people about it. Oh, yes, I go there every year, and oh, I'd love it there. And so it's a very nice place to be in the summer. But also, I wanted to have some time because I'd seen photographs of the console. And if you've seen the movie Airplane, and who hasn't, think of that gag where Robert Hayes' character gets into the cockpit after assuring everybody he can handle it, and looks at the cockpit, and there's a panning shot across the controls of the plane that goes on for what feels like a minute or two. And I kind of had that reaction. And now, one of the things that organists know, but most people may not be aware of, is that, especially when you have an instrument that has five keyboards plus the pedals. The stop tabs on either side of you, in this case, are labeled by the name assigned to the manual. And from one organ to the next, they may not be named in the same way. So you have to figure out, okay, I just think 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, okay. And usually somewhere in the middle or near the top is the one that's called the great, which is where all your fluty sound and all your power, and there's a lot of sound there. And then the other manuals have different sounds assigned to them. And each manual on this particular organ, as is the case with a lot of pipe organs, not theater organs, each manual has its own set of stop tabs. And you have to look to your left and to your right and look at all the little stop tabs and figure out what sound and group of sounds goes with which manual, and then remember what that is by the time your eyes go from the stop tabs to the manuals. And then, even if you learn it, then you have the added factor. Once the show begins, I forget sometimes. It's an absolutely gorgeous space with amazing acoustics. I used a microphone, but you know, this is built at the turn of the last century, I think, and or maybe longer. And it's one of those huge wooden spaces where the acoustics are just excellent.
I think it was built for sort of Chautauqua kind of meetings for people give lectures and speeches.
Oh, definitely. It's this huge, beautiful wooden structure that seats, I think, 700. And Mon is sitting there watching me have this Ted Stryker reaction to the console. I'm not a conservatory-trained organist, and I can't just sit down and go, oh, yes, this and this and this, and then turn things on and off and set pistons, and I'm set. It takes me a lot longer. And it really took me at least half an hour, 45 minutes of looking and tapping and plunking away and noodling until I really got a handle on things. And also, the stops themselves, the ranks of pipes, have different names. And sometimes it's French, sometimes it's German. And then you have to remember what that word is and what type of sound it corresponds to. And again, organists generally know, oh, this is this and this is this. But I'm only just now getting used to seeing, oh, if I see something and it's spelled H-A-U-T-B-O-I-S, oh, I know what kind of a reedy sound that is. And stuff like that. But like I said, it's a lot of ranks.
Did that organ have a toy counter at all?
No, it doesn't have not a toy counter, not sound effects, but it has tuned percussion, which I like to use, and I think you'll hear it in the recording sample that's coming up. So I always got to find, okay, where are the bells? Where's the chrysoglot? And if there's a film that has something with bells, like chimes, okay, does this have chimes? Where is it? How do I find it when I need it? And that sort of thing. But eventually, and Mona said she noticed when I was playing, all of a sudden, oh, I think Ben's okay now. That sounds like Ben's playing. And there was this light bulb moment where I realized, oh, okay, I got it. So these sounds are here, these sounds are there, these sounds are here. I can put these here, put this other one's here, here and there, and mix and match. And I had my presets set up, and I started playing. You know, when I sit down at an instrument, I'll play the silent comedy watch party on the theme on the organ just for the hell of it. So I did get to this moment where it clicked. It just took me a really long time.
I should imagine also complicated, because if you're on a piano or if you're on a familiar instrument that you've played before, you don't have to look for it. You have to be watching the film. So your eyes are got half of the time there at the screen, and then the added complication of an unfamiliar organ is that you have to use your eyes to find where stops stuff is, things. Yeah.
One of the great things about a theater organ is that pretty much they're all laid out the same way. You find your reeds in the same area on every instrument. The strings are here. The percussion is here. The one organ may have certain stop tabs yellow, where another one might have them in red or white, et cetera, et cetera. But, you know, I can sit down at pretty much any theater pipe organ or digital theater organ, and I know it's like getting into a rental car. You know... Oh, the defroster's over here. Oh, that's not the lights. That's the radio. And then you're set. but this is like getting into a stick shift on, oh, I don't drive a stick. Well, you've got one, sir. Okay. The show itself went okay for me. Went better for the audience because it's Buster Keaton and it's Our Hospitality. And what was nice is that, you know, this is their first year at the Ocean Grove Camp Meeting Association where they've had programming during the summer now that things are, you know, reopening, etc. And what I heard afterwards was the turnout we had was the highest turnout they had for any event they'd offered all summer.
Oh, wonderful.
And I said, well, you know, that's Keaton, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And possibly the novelty of what we were doing. There was a lot of people who came that were people I knew and didn't know were coming. Before the show started, I'm pacing around the auditorium. We're up on the stage, and I see somebody with a Silent Comedy Watch Party T-shirt waving me down. And said, "Oh, you know, I know you're busy. I just want to say hello and thank you for doing the Silent Comedy Watch Party. It got me through the pandemic, and just wanted to thank us for the lift it gave him." And standing not too far from him was Mana, and she said, I forget exactly what she said, but she started saying to him something thanking him, and he turns to her. He goes, "Are you Mana?" Because he recognized her voice, and she said, "Yes." I said, "Oh, can I get?" He says, "Can I get a selfie with you?" So it was the first of a number of moments I've had doing in-person shows where people who gotten through the pandemic because of the being able to watch the Silent Comedy Watch Party and get some laughs have come up to any of us and said hello.
Oh, that's just great.
Yeah, yeah.
This clip sounds like fun and sounds like the audience is having fun.
Yes, this is from Our Hospitality with Buster Keaton. This is one of those programming things that was very specific. This was their annual Victorian Day at Ocean Grove Camp Meeting Association. So they wanted something that fit the Victorian era. So the closest thing I could come, especially thinking of something that would be fun and entertaining, was Our Hospitality, because the year it takes place kind of fits. It starts at the beginning of the sequence where Buster is fishing. So you'll hear some light music there. You'll hear the dam break. And the big laugh that you hear is the moment when there's that water wall deluge that separates Buster from the guys who are trying to shoot him. So this is from a show I did in the middle of August 2022 at the Great Auditorium in Ocean Grove Camp Meeting Association in Ocean Grove, New Jersey, on a massive Robert Hope Jones pipe organ.
Thank you.
That was a few minutes of Ben's improvised accompaniment to Buster Keaton's Our Hospitality, recorded at the Great Hall of the Ocean Grove Camp Meeting Association in August 2022. Ben, listening to that clip, I heard something that we've talked about in a couple of episodes, which is rather than sort of just pouring the music on, doing those Chaplin Modern Times pauses.
Oh, yeah.
I heard some stop and go in there. It's as if you had listened to yourself from a podcast earlier this year and said, that's going to fit here.
Yeah, I mean, I've been doing that all along in the last several years, and I'm trying to do it more.
Well, the nice thing about taking a melody and then stretching it and breaking it is the existence of a melody with a certain shape and going, you know, to the left and then back to the right, as melodies do, sets up a level of expectation for the audience. So it's not just, here's a note, here's a note, here's another note. It's, okay, so there's a melody, but now there's a break. It's like, and I think I know, as a listener, what's coming, but now you're building suspense about when it's going to come. And whether it's going to sound the way I anticipated. It's a little bit the way songwriters use rhyme. Mm-hmm. You hear a rhyme and now you're going to wait for, in fact, you might even start guessing
where it's going. Yeah.
Yeah. What the rhymed word is going to be. Even if you're not doing it consciously, your mind is aiming towards that rhyme. And I think breaking a melody up does the same thing. Your brain has a direction to go.
And I also tried to do the same thing with a melodic line where I'm slowing down or speeding up, and not just stopping and starting, but that's something I've noticed in listening to score recordings that Lee Irwin did, that rather than stop or to punctuate the way some other accompanists may do, you can just do the same thing without it being so noticeable by just slowing down and speeding up. Slowing down and speeding up, breathing as opposed to just a nonstop wall of music, which is something I try not to do. And I think that it's something that's an easy habit to get into, that there's this constant wall-to-wall carpet of music running throughout. And there's something that I've been trying to do as I see a scene is getting ready to wrap up. I try to make my way to the end of the phrase, and so as soon as I see the fade-out begin, I can resolve, take a half a second pause, and move on to something else to go with the fade-in to whatever's next. Even if it's a film I haven't seen, if I'm keeping it real simple, no matter what I start with, I quickly modulate from major to minor, or minor to major, or if I'm doing some little legato line, I can have it turn into something that is correct, even if I don't know where it's going. But I'm trying to do this thing where, rather than play through the fade out, fade in from one sequence to the next one, I resolve and stop and then move on.
Speaking of adaptation to instruments, you had a severe adaptation to make for a performance of the French Foreign Legion film Under Two Flags.
Yes.
Directed by, of all people, Todd Browning. That was surprising me.
Yeah, I mean, it's a film that shows that he can direct things that don't have Lon Chaney disfigured and in the leading role in them. It's a universal super jewel, and I think Browning was one of their main directors, and I guess he was assigned to this picture. Under Two Flags was released somewhere in the fall of 1922, and the Everett Theatre in Middletown, Delaware, opened on November 9th, 1922, and the picture that opened the place was Under Two Flags. It's a beautiful, historic theater, and because it's there and it's still functioning, it's one of those many of the historic movie theaters that fell into hard times or lack of use and was rescued by a community organization that formed a not-for-profit, raised money, etc. Several months ago, someone from the theater had contacted me because they were looking to plan centennial events for the theater, and they wanted to show the film that opened the theater, Under Two Flags, and found me online, and so they booked me, and it fit nicely into my schedule because I wound up booking myself to play the next day at Ursinus College in Collegeville, Pennsylvania, which is like one stop on the Amtrak away. So the Everett Theatre has an old electronic theater organ in it, and that's what I wound up using. One thing I definitely want to mention about the theater, many people listening may actually know the theater but not realize it. If you've seen Dead Poets Society, the interior of the Everett Theater is what was used as the boarding school's theater.
Oh, where they did,
Midsummer Night's Dream. Midsummer Night's Dream. And they have a banner from, they believe it was a prop or set dressing from the film that has the name of the Hayden Hall or something like that, presents A Midsummer Night's Dream, and they have that hanging there. And also, in the auditorium, when Robin Williams passed, they put a black seat cover or upholstery over the seat where Robin Williams' character sat in the film. So that's one thing where actually some people may actually know what the interior of the Everett Theater looks like. The projection there is fantastic. They have a pair of 35mm, I think they're Centuries, that were put in the early 40s. They're still there. They still work. And they still occasionally they show film in 35mm. They showed The Godfather in 35. They got a Technicolor print of Snow White for something, and they have an excellent digital video projection system as well. And the guy there, Michael, who's the projectionist, is an old projectionist who really knows what he's doing. I mean, it's got a red curtain that opens after the main title hits the screen, and what impressed the heck out of me is that he had already watched the video, saw how long the VN title was, and so the curtain closed just in time when the film ended and the VN hits the screen. And that's a very special skill, because silent films, the end title is usually like 4 seconds long. And a curtain takes longer than 4 seconds to close. So you've got to back time the whole thing. You've got to be watching the counter on the player and know when to start the curtain. And it wasn't until it happened when the film ended, I thought, oh my gosh. He backtimed the end title for the curtain, and it's so rare to see that happen. So it was really great. Now the instrument I had to play was a Baldwin Cinema 2. It's an instrument from the 1980s, and Lee Irwin recorded a number of his organ scores for Raymond Rohauer on an instrument like that. I think not all of them were done at the Carnegie Hall Cinema Wurlitzer. And the Kino Ultimate Edition of Three Ages that came out on DVD and Blu-ray in the 2000s has that score on it. If you have that DVD, you can hear some of that. And there's a delightful little theme that Lee came up with for Buster. And so I kind of knew what I was getting into before I arrived. I knew it was going to be an electronic theater organ, so nothing was really going to sound like a real organ. This is before sampling ever existed. And what was surprisingly simple to me is that, I guess because I'd been hearing and listened to some of Lee's Keaton scores recorded on an instrument like this, I was already a little familiar with the way this instrument sounded. So it doesn't have a lot of different instrument sounds. It doesn't have a lot of ranks to it. But I was really surprised at how quickly I found my way around the instrument.
Mm-hmm.
Under Two Flags, which I keep reminding myself to not call Under Two Jags, which is the name of the Stan Laurel spoof of it. It's, you know, it's a foreign legion theme, but it's somewhere out in the Middle East, and so there's a lot of that. There's a sheik, and there are, you know, people in what we now call brown face and turbans and beards and stuff like that. And as we've talked before about when discussing the Tong War sequence in The Cameraman, I didn't want to play that, you know, a lot of stuff that's in that scale that people just assume is anything Arabian.
That Scheherazade.
Yeah, yeah.
Hi.
Remba! Shalash, shalash! But I didn't want to just go too over the top. It's the same rule that I usually have. You can see who it is. You don't need to reinforce it with the music necessarily. It's fine for Arabian in Tchaikovsky's Nutcracker because you expect it, but this is something else. So in the moments that had, you know, people dancing or they had a lot of sheiks on camels, I played the moment as opposed to playing something that sounded like it was however authentic or cartoony of that culture. It's not, you know, it wasn't really necessary. So why don't we listen to some of this, and then I can talk a little bit about what happened during the show and how it was received. You had mentioned before we started recording, Kerr, about the separation of the sound. And I have, the way I've been recording my shows is I have a Zoom H2N digital recorder. And one of the settings on it is called mid-side, and it uses three microphones, one that points straight out, and then two on a left and right side. And I've been using that for some of my close-miked recordings lately, and I find that it has more separation than the usual XY 90-degree pattern. If you know this mic and you know anything about audio, that might make sense to you. But by placing my Zoom recorder about 8 feet away, pointed straight at the back of the organ, that's how you'll hear what you're hearing. So, and you'll see what I was able to do with the small variety of different sounds on it.
Listen to this clip on your headphones if you can.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. There's no ping pong stuff like from the late 50s, but you'll get to hear what the instrument sounds like. Here's a few minutes from my score for Under Two Flags, recorded live in performance at the historic Everett Theatre in Middletown, Delaware. Yours truly at a Baldwin Cinema 2 electronic theatre organ. Thank you. recorded live in performance on November 9th at the historic Everett Theatre in Middletown, Delaware, a few minutes from my score for Under Two Flags, playing at Baldwin Cinema 2 Electronic Theatre Organ. What was remarkable about this show is, you know, the organizers and I were both very aware of the image quality, in air quotes, of it, but it was what's available, and what the organizers of the event really wanted to do was have the people in the room be sitting where people sat exactly 100 years ago watching the same movie. And I initially thought, well, I'm going to have to work a little harder because of the image quality and all this stuff, so to help people understand what's going on, I may need to lean in musically a little bit. They had a pretty much a full house. And this is the first time they've done a silent film. They had not done, you know, 5 years of Phantom of the Opera and Nosferatu on Halloween. They might have done one or two before, but I was really wondering what was going to happen, because who shows Under Two Flags, and in a community where nobody is really that familiar with the experience of going to a silent movie, who's going to show up? And they had a pretty packed house, which really speaks to the kind of community support there is for the Everett Theatre. And it's really just one, you could just sense it in the room as at half hour. But I noticed about 5 minutes in, and this is something, it's hard to describe, but anybody who's a film accompanist who's listening will know what I'm talking about, is that you can sense that the audience is, they're clicked in. You know, they're connected to the film and wrapped with attention. I don't know, maybe 10 years ago, I was at the Fall Cinestation in Maslin, Ohio, and I was playing for something. It was a Nell Shipman movie, and it was one of the morning shows, and I'd gone and I volunteered to take the first show of the day. It was me and Philip Carley, the two accompanists. And Philip came in after the film had started, but he said to me afterwards, he said something nice about the job I did on the score, but he said, I felt the tension in the room, you know. And for me, especially with a first-time audience, you always wonder how it's going to go, especially, you know, it's not 1 week in Steamboat Bill Jr., it's not Safety Last, where you can pretty much, by the second minute in, you know, people's radar mentally has shifted and they're in. But for an audience of pretty much all first-timers, a movie they've never heard of, that they've never seen, they don't know anything about it, but they absolutely were in it. And you could feel it. And I kept checking in every once in a while. Sometimes if I would have one of those moments where I stopped playing or pause, I could sense it. You know, there's this sixth sense you develop as a film accompanist. You can just tell. And it's not just film accompanists. I discovered Mana's friend, David Loud, who was in Merrily We Roll Along with her, and who is a music director and conductor on Broadway for many, many years.
And let me say, he just published an excellent memoir. So go look for Amazon.
Yes, called Facing the Music, in which I believe he talks about this very facet as a conductor. And I saw him give a talk at the 92nd Street Y. It was a concert where he read segments from the book, and musical numbers were also performed. But he talks about facing the stage and looking to the orchestra and looking up at the performance, but also being able to sense out of the back of his head or back of his neck, he can sense that the audience is with the show and it's on the ride. And so maybe conductors get this as well. But that really, really impressed me about that show. People were there to be there for the theater. There were politicians, the mayor, plaques were presented to the head of the theater. It was really quite something. And because it was the film that opened the theater, shown on the 100th anniversary to the day of when the theater opened, you know, the thing I often tell an audience about, we're going to put you in a time machine. Mm-hmm. Don't worry, we're going to bring you back. but this is something else I was aware of when I would play or watch films at the Lincoln Theater in Massillon, is that when you're in a historic movie theater, you're aware of the proscenium. Because of the light coming off the screen. I felt the same thing in the Vardenstheatret in Tromsø, Norway. You're aware of the proscenium around the screen and maybe the walls, and you, out of the corner of your mind, you're aware I'm sitting in the space seeing this movie the same way people did decades ago. But there was a theater organ installed at the Everett when it opened, and the two chambers on either side of the stage are still there. And so... without my bringing my portable virtual Wurlitzer and bringing that in, short of that, it was really awfully close to what happened exactly 100 years prior in that very space. Mm. So it was a really special night, very successful, and I look forward to having an opportunity to do something else at the Everett in the new year.
Makes your head spin to think that we can look at entertainment products that are literally 100 years old and not just for antiquarian value, you know, but to be entertained by them.
Well, that's a big part of what the class I teach at Wesleyan is about, and my book, The Silent Film Universe, is all about, which is that because of what's not on screen and which we fill in with our imaginations, which we bring with us from our own human experience, that's what's sort of the equalizer, or the thing that makes it something we can still be entertained by. Even though the stories we're watching are 100 years old, the stories are basically... It makes me think of... And when I was in grad school, the 1 year I was in grad school, I remember going to an event at the Paley Center, which I think was called the Museum of Broadcasting at the time. It was an event for your show of shows. And Sid Caesar was there, and I got to go to the reception afterwards. And there was a line of people to ask him questions, and I got on the line. And I asked him a question that probably a lot of people weren't, because most people ask, what was it like doing this? Did you ever meet Milton Berle, et cetera, et cetera. And I was fascinated with what works and why things hold up over time. And I asked Sid Caesar, why is it you think that your comedy is held up, for decades and generations? And he said, I never did anything topical or political. I always concentrated on the human equation.
Mm-hmm.
He said, a young guy on a date trying to get his arm around his girl is the same, in one era after another. It never changes. And I think that at the core, a lot of the stories in silent films are that's what's universal. And that's why I could show The Freshman in South Korea, and everybody laughed and got all the jokes and went along on the story, on the ride with the story, just like an American audience would. It's the same. It's a young person going off to college, and somebody is sick, and they can't stitch up your pants, or you're in a football game, and even if they don't have football in South Korea, it's a sports match, And I think that's why, as long as whatever your comfort level is with a lot of the cultural stuff and gender stuff, etc., you can still find something of yourself and your own life experience in what the proceedings, so that it doesn't matter that it was shot in 1911 or 1926 or whatever.
It's almost tragic then that Lois Weber's film Shoes is also still relevant, still relatable, story of economic and social justice and women's economic roles. A 1916 film that still talks to the audience today, and you accompany that.
Yeah. The following day, I got on a train, went to Collegeville, Pennsylvania, where Ursinus College is, and Professor Holly Hubbs and Professor Jennifer Flieger have me out every other year, and of course, there's a bigger gap during COVID, and I'll do something where I meet with a bunch of students and do a little talk and masterclass on film scoring in the silent era, and then in the evening I accompanied Shoes. And actually, what I did, because Shoes is only about 50 minutes, it's a about a young woman who is trying to make her way in the world and looking for employment and struggling to make ends meet. I thought of the Alice Howell comedy, Her Lucky Day, which I pitched to Jennifer. And I said, just to make the to fill out the show, and also it's another female star, and I don't while Alice Howell doesn't get screen credit as director or writer or gag writer, she definitely was involved, and I thought it would be fun to fill out the program. So we showed that as well. Jennifer liked the idea, and also my idea to close the show with the short, since Shoes is a heavy issue film. Sometimes the short is good to warm up the audience, but just to leave people on a lighter note, we showed Her Lucky Day, which I think is one of my favorites of her Real Craft two-reelers. But Shoes is a film I show my students every year, and I'll be teaching again at Wesleyan this spring. It's my favorite of the Lois Weber features that I've seen. It's an issue film, but there's so much about the visual storytelling language and how much we are given and we are not given and are asked to identify from our own life experience with what we're seeing on camera, where we're not being spoon-fed information about our lead character's emotional state in intertitles. It's just really, really effective. And if you've seen the film, you'll understand one of my favorite shots in the film is a scene where the young woman is walking in the rain, and there's this close-up of her walking. It's just from her, you know, from her calves down in the rain, a tracking shot, and it's on screen for 4 or 5 seconds. But it's this detail where we cut into this one detail, and then cut back to something else, and we are asked to see these three things, the wide shots and then the insert, and come up with something from it. But it's, you think it's 1916, the idea of creating this shot and what took, you know, what went into making it. And there's the other thing, and this is what you'll hear, is there's a moment where our lead character, played by Mary McLaren, whose performance is extremely understated and subtle. And again, for a 1916 drama, that's not common at all. There is a moment where she is all by herself in her room, and she's in a rooming house with her family, but she's in her room, and she has come to a point in her quest for, you know, and she works in a 5 and 10, and which I tell my students, it's like the dollar store today, sort of. And, you know, but she's a working class girl. Her shoes are worn out. This whole thing about, it isn't just about the shoes. It's about what you do in order to replace something essential like that, where her father isn't getting work and there's no money for it. They're not eating well. The whole family lives together through a coworker at the 5 and 10. Our lead character has met this young man who's a bit of a dandy, I suppose, and has offered to. And it's never spelled out super clearly in titles, but he's offered to buy her a pair of shoes if she would, you know, dot, dot, dot. And again, it's all up to us to figure out. But there's a moment where she has resisted all of this and has to make a decision. And there is, it's a couple of minutes of screen time where we just watch her. She doesn't indicate anything. She doesn't, you know, fold her arms and look down at her shoes and tap her finger on her forehead. I mean, it's nothing like that. And yet you can tell what she's thinking, which a lot of that is her performance and Lois Weber's direction. But it's also Lois Weber's decision to just point the camera at her. And maybe there's one or two inserts. And so what happened to me is I'm playing a big old pipe organ, not as massive as the one in Ocean Grove, but it's one with similarly has some more orchestral sounds. There is a, I can't remember what the stop is called, but it's like a glockenspiel or a chrysoglock. There's bells, and if you sense another theme, it's that I like to use that every once in a while because it's very effective. So what we're going to hear is a few minutes from this. I believe it's the sequence when our protagonist has to have this internal monologue about all the things that are going on and make the decision. From what happened to me is I had just played this show the night before on this other instrument, stayed in the hotel, got on a train, came to here, had lunch, met with the students, and then got acclimated to this organ, which I'd played before, but it's been a while. And I actually didn't really know what kind of a sound palette I was going to wind up using for this film. And as soon as it started, I had this visceral reaction where I found myself, instead of having to give myself a note, "You can always play less, and you're not being paid by the note," that I found myself playing less and holding things more. I mean, it's not that obvious in the recording, but it is something I felt myself, as I would play, hear in my mind, "Oh, that's too many notes, that's too much." And I would just hold on a note or just play, or at least play slower. This as a way to help the audience connect with our protagonist, because, like I said, not all of it is spelled out for us in titles, what's going on in her mind.
Mm-hmm.
It's up to us to understand, and there isn't a way to really, in a literal way, enforce it with music, but just to help people get up and into
and
it. So here,
leave space for her to think, and
yeah,
for them to think with her or to see her.
Right, right. It's about the audience connecting with our character on screen, and helping them fuse with that person so they understand what's going on. So here's a few minutes from my live performed live score for Shoes, directed by Lois Weber.
Thank you.
live in performance at Bomberger Hall at Ursinus College. Yours truly accompanying Shoes, the 1916 feature-length film directed by Lois Weber and starring Marion McLaren. The instrument is the Hefner Memorial Organ, which was gifted to Ursinus by Mrs. Lydia Hefner. It is an Austin organ, 3 manuals, 62 ranks, and 72 stops. I am still trying to understand the difference between ranks and stops, even though to me they're kind of the same thing. And if you're an organist, you're probably yelling at your your iPhone right now what the difference is. But it's still a lot. There's those bells, and there are some sounds on it that are not just the basic tootsie flootsie stuff.
Yeah,
that's on it.
Bell work was really lovely. The film, yeah. If you're wondering, because it does sound serious, was very well reviewed and was actually one of Universal's biggest hits that year. It was very successful. It had a very ironic afterlife because someone thought it would be cute in the 1930s to make a 10-minute cut and add a soundtrack that ridiculed the film. And it was released, and I think some other silent films that fate was visited upon in the 30s.
Yeah. Yeah, that happened a lot. And part of the restoration, this is a restoration done by the Eye Film Museum and released on home video by Milestone Home Video, is that it only existed in incomplete form. And then this print turned up in the iFilm archives with Dutch titles. And there was a restoration done with digital cleanup and that sort of thing. And titles were translated back to English from the Dutch titles. And the first time I ever showed it in my class, this is years ago, that's what we licensed and showed, in which had, I think, played some festivals. And then subsequently, cutting continuity or something like that turned up in the Universal Archives. And so they were able to go back and remake the titles back into the original text. But it's a great film. It's one where I find that my students in their midterm essay wind up citing a couple of moments from the film in their essays when I ask them to talk about certain aspects of the language of silent film. It's just visually very, very, very compelling. And if you haven't seen it, check it out. Like I said, it's available on DVD and Blu-ray. And I believe it's also streaming on the Milestone Films streaming service. And I think, the score is by Donald Sosa. And I think it's Donald and his wife, Joanna. So it's available, and it's great, a great film.
Ben, in our last podcast, we had some listener questions, and while I don't have any new ones, I do have one that I think is a follow-on from an answer you gave in our last episode that I'd like to know before we go. We talked about the leitmotif style of scoring, and I wonder, now, if you were sitting down to play a 80, 90-minute film, and it has 5 major characters and maybe a thematic theme. What do you use as your aide de mémoire? How do you remember your different themes? Do you have a little cheat card of 4 bars of a tune? Or
well, sometimes I just try really hard to remember by the intervals. In other words, the distance on the keyboard or in the musical scale between one note and the other for the sequence of 5 or 6 notes that a melody might be. So this is one of the things I learned from Lee Irwin when I started playing for films, about how to construct a melody and how to come up with, to create also a memorable melody, something that's not necessarily catchy, but isn't just wandering all over the keyboard.
Well, and when it reappears, the audience will recognize it.
Right, exactly. So, you know, choosing a number of or a sequence of intervals is one thing, and then trying to remember it the next time. Sometimes it's just like, oh, I really like that. I hope I can remember it. And I'll make a note as I'm playing it, and I'll play it a second time to if it fits for the film, so it sticks in my head. And sometimes I will, because there's just so much music I have to churn out, as a way to come up with something, and it's only something that I will know about during the show and the audience will never have any idea, is something I came up with when I was scoring, I must have scored 30 shorts for the Edison set years and years ago. And, there's a moment when you're playing for a lot of stuff that you... At least I feel like I hit a point of having musical dry heaves, where it's like, ah. And Philip, Carly, and I would talk about this the first few years of Slapstickon before Andrew joined us. And even after that, it's still, how many shorts, so many comedy shorts. Like, by the end of the second day, I got nothing else. But I remember having to come up with a score for something called The Wonders of Magnetism. It's a little educational one-reeler made by the Edison Company. And those are hard enough to come up with music for. And I wanted to come up with some kind of a theme. And I came up with a theme that fit a phrase. And this is something else I learned from Lee, just about songwriting in general. And I think you'll probably appreciate this, Kerr, because you're also of the theater and lyric writing and dealing with musicals, is to create a melody that matches the way you would say the phrase. Mm-hmm. And some of the best lyrics are things, or songs are things where the melody and the rhythm of it and the way it goes up and down matches the way you would say it out loud. So I came up, what did I come up? I think I came up with Thomas Edison. Yeah, he's a real smart guy. And I came up with a melody that fit Thomas Edison. Yeah, he's a real smart guy. And I would bring that around a few times, and I know you'll go find your Edison set and find it, and you'll, and now it's not like it's not like it's the kid brother, and every time you hear me play, which is why I try not to do obvious things, because then, oh, there's your theme for whatever. But who's going to watch The Wonders of Magnetism? But I've begun doing that, so I'll take the name of the leading lady or leading man or the name of the film. Mm-hmm. And come up with a melody that fits the rhythm and the way you would say it. And one of the neat things that happened, in The Crowd, the movie The Crowd, at the end, John and Mary have that scene where she's about to leave him, and he tells her, convinces her to stay, and he puts on a record. And it's a song called There's Everything Nice About You. And I wound up using that as a theme, because nobody knows the song. Mm-hmm. And then when they put the record on, I play it as written. But that's a song where the lyric fits the melody. It's there's something nice about everyone, but there's everything nice about you. And that's the way the song really sounds like.
There's something nice about everyone, but there's everything nice about you.
I bring my Victrola into my class and I play the record for my students, but that's another example. Cole Porter does it, Sondheim. So that's like a mnemonic device that I'll do sometimes. I'll just take the character's name or the performer's name or the name of the film and use that as if I was creating a theme for them where the chorus was their name.
Mm-hmm.
Makes it a little easier. Because I am trying not only to do that, but as I mentioned last time, inspired by what Bill Perry was saying about leitmotifs, and trying to do it a little bit more. This is a new experiment for me.
Mm-hmm.
I usually, as I mentioned last time, will try to do it less so people aren't aware of it. And I'd rather than wonder if I was using leitmotifs and I was, but they weren't aware of it, because the opposite can also be a problem. Then it calls attention to itself.
Yes.
It becomes like a Peter and the Wolf kind of thing. But the other possible downside is that the audience becomes aware of the score.
Mm-hmm.
It'll be interesting to see how this experiment plays out over the next year or two. I don't want people to be super aware of my score, but this is one of the things about doing something in a score where the audience is aware of what you're doing and people are aware of the score. It's a weird thing to want, but I'd rather have what happens often to me is that people who've just seen me play for 2 hours will come up to me and just start talking about the movie.
Mm-hmm.
I'd rather them get a huge bang out of the film than worry about whether they've liked my score or not.
And now, as we prepare to sign off, in place of our usual Keystone Cops theme, we have some seasonal music played by silent film accompanist Ethan Uslan. Thanks much, Ethan, for letting us use this.
I've got a lot of other things coming up this month. I'm hunkering down and trying to finish up the Raymond Griffith project. Work continues on the Tom Mix restoration and scoring. And there's other things going on. I'm working on yet another draft of the manuscript for my book. But there's a lot to aim forward to in the new year. And among other things, Undercrank Productions will be celebrating the 10th anniversary of its first release in June. And the Ernie Kovacs book is back on track, and it'll be out sometime in the late spring, I think. This has been episode 54 of the Silent Film Music Podcast with Ben Modell. It's the podcast that takes you inside the mind of someone as they prepare for, perform, and reflect upon performances of live musical accompaniments to silent films. I'm Ben Modell. I'm a silent film accompanist, historian, presenter, educator, and home video label, and many other hats. And I'm here, as always, with my co-producer, co-host, my friend, Kerr Lockhart. Thanks for keeping the home fires burning and keeping this podcast going along all year, and for helping us share all this information and music with everyone who's been listening.
It's fun catching our stride this year, I think.
Yes, definitely. And if you listen to the podcast, and I'm assuming you're listening to it now, send us a message. Go to my website, silentfilmmusic.com. We'd love to hear, or on the Facebook page we have, and we'll be back with another episode of the Silent Film Music Podcast in the new year. Until then, have a great holiday season. Kerr, have a great holiday.
You too.
With you and yours, and thank you very much. And until then, virtually or in person, I'll see you at the Silence.